Ça y est, j'ai lancé le direct. Ouais, que t'étais. Non, tu disais quoi? Oui, bien sûr. Ah oui, ça oui, je vais le faire, ouais. Ça marche. Ok, ça va. Bon, bah, je fais ça. À tout de suite. Eh bien, bonjour à tous, bienvenue et merci au RTMFM de me permettre de vous présenter quelques progrès que nous avons faits récemment concernant l'imagerie SMLM multicolore. Alors, je vais peut-être le faire en anglais, mais bon, ça sera pas très compliqué. So, thank you very much. And welcome to my small talk about single molecule localization microscopy in multicolor. So I hope everything is fine. If not, just shout in the talk in the chat box. Thank you. So the problem or the limitation of optical microscopy, as you are all aware, is that my microscope and your microscope too cannot see below 200 nanometer in standard situation because of the diffraction of light. So the best thing you can see, even if your emitter is infinitely small, is a spot that is around 200 nanometer in width and 500 nanometer in height. And this is called the point spread function. And if you look at single molecule, this is what you see. You see your point spread function around 200 nanometer in width. And if you look at small things, like for example, this dendrite of a neuron, you see that this image is pixelated, of course, but it is also a bit blurry. And the blur is because you have this, the details, for example, the presynapses that are labeled with Bassoon are around the size of the PSF. So fortunately, we have new ways to get around that this limitation, and several techniques called super resolution microscopy, and I will talk about one of them, that is single molecule localization microscopy. So the principle is quite simple. It's that you are like decomposing your labeling into single events of fluorescence from each fluorophore, and if they are isolated enough, you can isolate them and localize them by Gaussian fitting. So you accumulate all the localizations in your sample until you get this much more resolved image here, for example, a stochastic optical reconstruction image store. So if we look at it as a movie, you see that you have individual localization and you fit them with Gaussians, and then you can accumulate these localizations on thousands of frames, of tens of thousands of frames. You see here accumulating, and in the end you see the storm image that is much more resolved than the diffraction limited image on top here. There are several ways to do single molecule localization microscopy that differ in the way you generate this blinking of the fluorophore. Storm, which is based on organic fluorophore blinking in fixed cells. PALM, where you are photoactivating fluorescent protein fusions, and can be done in living cells. And PAINT, where instead of fluorophores that are directly attached to antibodies, you are using the transient binding of fluorescent DNA strands. So I will show you how we use this and how we use this to do multicolor imaging, which is still today a current limitation. It's difficult to do this in several colors, as I'm sure some of you may know, because a lot of people try to do that. So one of the first technique to do multicolor storm is very simple, is to try to find two different fluorophores with different spectra that can blink in the same buffer. And so the best fluorophore for storm currently is the FARED Alexa Fluor 647. And of course, people have tried a lot of other fluorophores in the green or in the red part of the spectrum. So you have a list of them here. And for example, if you see here in this paper from the Sauer lab, you see that two color images of the nuclear pore complexes with the second color blinking of ATO 520. The problem is that it's difficult to get a good blinking of this second fluorophore, and difficult to find a good buffer to have the two fluorophore blinking well. Plus, if you have something that is away in the spectrum, you will get chromatic aberrations, and these chromatic aberrations have to be corrected, because at the scale of the SMLM, you have to correct very finely the chromatic shift between the two channels induced by the difference in the spectrum. A good way to do it, and it works quite well, is if one of these colors is actin, because it has been shown that phthalidine with a green fluorophore like ATO-488 blinks readily in pure PBS. So you can do two color with another Alexa Fluor 647 labeled target. But in this case, you have to switch the buffer PBS for the phthalidine and storm buffer for the 647. So it's a bit tedious, but here we used it back in 2015 to image actin at the initial segment to look at the actin rings and the spectrin in between these actin rings with a beta spectrin labeled with Alexa Fluor 647. Another way, which was, I think, historically the first way to do multicolor storm, was to use Alexa 647 for the blinking, but to stimulate it with an activator fluorophore. So instead of separating at the emission level, you are separating at the excitation level. So you make pulses of a second fluorophore that is attached to the same antibody, and depending on which wavelengths you excite, and then just after that you do a pulse of the 647, you can consider that the fluorophore blinks because you have excited it with some kind of threat from the 405 or the 561. And this was historically in 2007 the way people were doing two-color storm, such as these clathrin and microtubules you see here. This method is not really used anymore. It has some problems, like the low number of localizations. You have to discard a lot of what you would call spontaneous blinking. And also the crosstalk between the channels is around 10%, which means that you have a lot of crosstalk, so it's not very usable. So the last of the technique based on Storm is to combine Storm and Palm. So as I said, Palm is based on the photoactivable protein. So you can actually fluorescent protein like MEOs can blink in Storm buffer, or you can, like I did for phalloidine, switch the buffer between the MEOs imaging and the Alexa's Fluor 647. And for example, here you see imaging of actin and microtubule by combined Palm and Storm from the lab of Mike Eilemann in 2011. And we have tried this also, and this was a collaboration with Delphine Murio in Montpellier. And you can see here a Jurcat cell labeled for actin with Alexa Fluor 647 and imaging of GAG MEOs, which is the AIDS virus protein. And we can locate the virions and the actin and look at it. And you can get good images from both channels. So it is a possibility, but you have to express this protein tag with an MEOs. So it's not possible in every case. Now the technique we are using really routinely for a few years now is DNA paint, because this is really the technique that allows to make multicolor imaging much simpler. And this is based on, instead of having the fluorophore directly attached to the antibodies like in Storm, you have an intermediate that are small DNA strands, and these small DNA strands make the imaging transient, like you have this imager strand that is in the buffer, and it interacts transiently with your DNA strand that is on the antibody, which is called the docking strand. And this transient hybridization between the imager strand and the docking strand will make a flash, because it will immobilize the fluorophore of the imager strand, so that you will see a blinking. So the sequence will look exactly like Storm or paint, but the way you generate it is completely different. The advantage is that you don't need a special buffer. You are disconnecting the blinking and the photophysics from the excitation. It's not the dark state induced by the laser. And you can do easy multicolor, because you can combine different imager strands with different orthogonal DNA sequences on different targets. And it works as well, or at least as well, and sometimes even better than Storm. You can see here a direct comparison between microtubules imaged by Storm and Alexa Fluor 647, or by paint using an antibody with a sequence and a red imager strand. And it works also, as I said, readily for two colors. And you see here clathrine and microtubules image with two different imagers, one red and one far red, sequentially. And you see that both channels have a very good quality. And this is actually a 3D Storm image. So you can have also 3D information on both channels, here color coded on the right. And on the left, you see cross sections, which show you the clathrine coated pits near microtubules. And on the last one, the third panel, I think you even see the lumen of the microtubule at the bottom left of the screen, which tells you that this has a very good resolution. So, another thing is that, as it is a transient labeling hybridization, you can do this two color with two different imagers, but you can rinse it and make other channels, and then sequentially you can image as many targets as you want, as long as you have different species or you are using techniques that allows you to bypass the species problem. And for example, the first pass, you will do two color images, and then you wash, and then you will do two other targets with the same two colors, because you will have four different DNA sequences. And we have used this to do up to five colors nanoscopy. And this was a collaboration with Ricardo Henriquez, because we developed a pump made in LIGO that can automate the switch of all the buffers and imagers. And you see here across cells where we have image actin, mitochondria, microtubule, intermediate filaments, and clathrin by sequential multiplexed DNA paint. And it's not just to make a demonstration image. We are using this quite heavily in the lab. And for example, you know, we are studying neurons and the axon. And along the axon, you have this periodic scaffold of actin and spectrin every 190 nanometers, which is only visible by super resolution. And you see a tricolor image by combining storm for actin and then a single pass of DNA paint, which images adducin and spectrin, and we end up with a tricolor nanoscale image of this periodic scaffold. So what about more recent developments? So I showed you clathrin along in cost cells, and recently we have started to also upgrade our the way we look at this data, and in particular the 3D two-color paint data. So this is this has been applied first to a collaboration with Subhajit Roy, which is on bioarchive now. And you see here it's an axon, and this article deals about where is clathrin and how is clathrin transported along axons. So we were interested in those clusters that were transported along axons. And you see here the raw two-color paint data with the spectrin that delineates the membrane, the submembrane of the axon, and the clathrin that is inside the axon. And we are now using a rendering software to make it a lot easier to visualize the object and the clusters. And you can see that after rendering by the Chimera X software, we are able really to see where is the submembrane of the axon and where are each clathrin cluster and their shape, like they were silly putty objects, which makes it a lot more intuitive to manipulate. And you can generate movies to do cross sections such as this one. So this is an axon and the clathrin inside it, and you can make small cross sections and rotate them, and you see that each of these clathrin clusters is around 100 nanometer or even between 60 and 100 nanometer in equivalent diameter. So this is of course a very small objects that you can dissect and look at with this rendering method. And the next thing is a new way we are using to do two colors is to use spectral demixing. So spectral demixing is not new. It was pioneered back in 2010 and 2011. And it is based on imaging two colors, not because you are using two very distinct spectral fluorophores, but more using two fluorophores that are close in the far red channel. So they are blinking well and you don't have much chromatic aberration. So you excite them with the same laser as 640 nanometers, and then you split the emission between two cameras. And this is done thanks to our collaboration with the Abelite company and Caroline Friedel, who's a PhD student in our lab and working with Abelite. And so if you use a dichroic mirror that is well placed just in between the two fluorophores, like CF680 and AF647 here, of course you will get the blinking on both channels, but one will be more important than another depending on if it's Alexa Fluor 647 or CF680, and you can unmix and assign each blinking to either one or the other depending on their respective intensities in both channels. And you can see here at the left a two-color image of a neuron in 3D. This works also for 3D SMLM. And we are looking at here adducin and beta 2 spectrin, which are the components of this periodic cytoskeleton, and localizing the rings of spectrin and the rings of adducin that alternate along this neurite here in 3D. And the advantage is that this is simultaneous, so you do the two colors simultaneously, and this can be very fast. You see here, if we really push the Abelite setup to its maximum, we can do 3 millisecond frames, and 3 milliseconds with the two colors simultaneously allows us to make thousands of frames in 3 minutes, and we can get this image of microtubules and clathrin, which is now a 2D image, in less than 5 minutes easily. And you have the comparison with the classical storm we use so far, that with 20 frames per second, and the same image with a single color will take around 20 minutes. So you can imagine that the throughput will be much, much better with this spectral storm. The trade-off here, of course, is as it is simultaneous and you localize both channels on the same images, you cannot have as much high density of blinking. You have to be a bit lower in the density of blinking. And we are now applying this splitting this splitting setup from Abelight to also do two color simultaneous paint. So now we are not doing it with closely related fluorophore, but we are using the same red and far red fluorophore we used for sequential. And the advantages of that is that this is the problem of paint is that usually it is quite slow, but so we here we are two times faster because we are doing both channels at the same time using the splitter, and also we use the new fast paint imagers and docking strands from the Jungmann lab that allow to have a 10 times higher speed. And so it allows us to really have paint acquisition that are, I wouldn't say as fast as Storm, but not as slow as the classical paint. I would say we have 10 times faster paint images in two colors. So and as we acquire both channels at the same time, it is very efficient. So it really makes paint a good option for really high throughput data acquisition. And the last advantage of this fast paint method and this is that, as we have the demixing software, even if the crosstalk, a bit of crosstalk occurs between red and far red, we can actually reassign using the same algorithm as the demixing storm, and we can really make sure either to reassign each localization to the red channel or eliminate it if we see it in both channels. So this is even a good way that has not been shown so far, that demixing can actually be used also for two color splitting to have a higher quality of images and really annihilate completely the crosstalk. This is the end of my talk, and these are the people from the team, PhD students, met the conference technician, and our core collaborators on the left, the partnership we have with Nikon and Abilite, and our founders at the bottom. So thank you very much, and I'll be happy to answer your question now in the chat. So I just want to say something maybe before the questions arrive, that as you know, there is a 20 second shift between when I'm speaking and when you actually hear me. So I will reply to the questions, but there will be a slight delay between my replies and your questions. So Julia asks questions about what is the size of the DNA intermediate, like the docking strand and imaging strands we use for DNA paint, and can it make a higher displacement error for the fluorophore? So the DNA strands are quite small compared to the antibodies themselves. So it, I think it is adding a bit of error, but it should not be really significant compared to the displacement error from antibodies. So I would say the it is always an issue to have this displacement error with antibodies, and of course with paint it is also the case, but the difference is not that much. David Mazo asks a question related to the fact that we use primary and secondary antibodies, and is it possible to directly use label primaries? Indeed, it is absolutely possible, and it is even better for DNA paint, because then you are not limited by the problems of species, because you can directly tag, so you don't use secondaries anymore. So you can people that do like 8, 9, 10 color paint are actually directly tagging their primaries. It's just that it's a lot of work to do this tagging and coupling of DNA strands and the primaries. You have to have a high quantity of purified primaries for each one for the coupling reaction. So it's a bit expensive, but it's definitely a possibility. The other thing is that if you directly tag your primaries, you will have a smaller, you will have a lower amount of localization because you lack the amplification factor of several secondary antibody per primary antibody. Sylvain Loubet asks about how we manage the chromatic aberrations with the 3D. So the chromatic aberration right now for the 3D are just a simple shift. But for what we are doing is really we are using it to look at axons and neuronal processes that are never like higher than 1 micron above the cover slip. I agree that if you are starting to look inside the nucleus, for example, you have to have more you have to have more elaborate chromatic aberration correction in the Z direction because it starts to be an issue that cannot just be a different in the plane of your image. Benjamin has a question about DNA paint. How easy it is to find antibodies to do it. So we have been developing our own coupled DNA paint strands. So we can do a homemade coupling, which is not that difficult, but not really that easy either. But for now, we also work with the Massive Photonics company, which is the spin-off from the Jungmann lab. And they are making kits that are quite cheap compared to what, for example, UltiView used to do. And so they have standard rabbit and mouse secondary antibodies. So you can start readily with paint and try their kits. And this is what we use. And they're as good as our custom-made ones. And we are also working with them for more options like the fast paint or more species. So this can be an option to discuss with them if you want something more custom. So Sophie is asking about the possibility of doing DNA paint on tissue slices. So this is not something I have tried. I think the problem is that the paint, at least the way we do it now, you have the imagers in the solution, so you have a lot of background fluorescence. So it's really usable if you do a TURF or ILO imaging because you don't have the fluorescence of all the medium. So if you want to do it in slices, I would say you will have to be more azimuthal in your illumination, so you will get a lot of background fluorescence. And also you can have issues of the DNA sticking to the slice more than in a culture. There are ways and new probes for DNA paints that are fluorogenic, meaning that they are not fluorescent when they are in the solution, and they are fluorescent when they are bound to the docking strand. And this could be a way to alleviate this problem of background fluorescence and maybe have DNA paint in the slices. Sylvain has another question. What kind of experimental system you use to change easily your buffer without generating drift? It's a good question. So I can show you that's the good thing about being alive. So if we want to do very simply, we just have a small piece of tissue. So we suck the medium and we just put the new medium. And if you do it carefully, you have almost no shift, even at the nanoscale, because we are using stages and we make sure that everything is really not there is no slack. And I can show you. You can the automation pump we did with. So this is the pump. This is Pumpy. This is the Lego pump we have made with Ricardo Enriquez. And you see, it's controlled by Arduinos, and you have syringe. It's a syringe pump where you have this series of Lego motors that can push syringe. And with this, we can automate the change of the buffer for paint. And it's and you have to remove the liquid. You have this small peristaltic pump, and you just have it in the loading chamber, as you said, the perfusion ports of a loading chamber. And this works quite well because these motors make it quite slow. So the change is sufficiently slow so that you don't disturb at all your sample. This looks like Tele Achat now. So if there is no more questions, maybe I will stop the video. And if you have more questions or about when you look at the oh, there is, il y a encore du temps pour d'autres questions. On peut les faire en français même. Il n'y a pas de souci si vous avez des questions mais que vous voulez que je vous réponde en français. Il n'y a pas de problème. On peut faire ça dans comme vous voulez. Et puis sinon, merci à Brice hein, pour d'avoir géré tout ça. Si vous avez des questions quand vous revisionnez, vous pouvez m'envoyer un mail, il n'y a pas de souci à propos de tout ce que je montre pour discuter des aspects plus techniques. Merci à tous.